Okay, here we go. Welcome to the second week of the Site Building Academy. This is a presentation about HTML tags for a casino lobby. This continues the previous presentation on HTML, which talked about very generic aspects of HTML, and this goes down into greater detail with actual discussion about tags. What's important about tags is the fact that they all mean something in one way or another, and by meaning something, they all describe something in a certain way. So it's important to use the right tags in the right context, because in this way it makes the code readable, it makes Google happy because it can crawl your site and know what your site is about, and it's just a good practice. So let's begin. I think some of you know this website. This is a new Artemis bet. It's been launched a few days ago, and it has a generic architecture which is very similar to most of our casino websites. Just to analyze this page a bit, this page has a header. It has an area with breadcrumbs over here. It has a slider with some elements inside. It has a main content area, which is divided into two columns: a left column, which is the main content area of the site, and the side column with content which is less relevant to what you're seeing now, but it's there nonetheless. The point is that all of this is based in HTML, and we're going to analyze how that is today. So consider this website layout that you need to build. You need to be able to analyze what each area is about and describe it in HTML. And given the fact that HTML is a series of containers and descriptors, that's what we're going to talk about today. A series of containers and descriptors which are appropriate to some contexts inside the, our page. And the approach is that you take a page, a design, which is either a JPEG file or an actual PSD document, which is ideal in most cases. And you analyze it and come up with a structure and new tags for every section. We're not going to discuss architecture today, we're just going to discuss tags. And we'll see how the tags are reused across the layout and what they mean in context. So let's take the header. What do we use for the header as tags? So as a general container for the header, there's a new HTML5 tag called header, very explicitly. This is, by the way, different from head. Don't mistake it for the tag head. The tag head is unique in the web page. It describes the HTML area which has meta content, so content about content. The header tag is used inside the body tag, so in the content area, the visible content area of the website, and it describes a site header. So exactly what we've talked about today. So if you see this area in the context of the design, that top band which stays on the top of the website is the site header, and you need to be able to use the header tag to describe it. You do notice that here I've used the header tag. Inside there's some content. It's less relevant what content comes inside because we're only discussing the use of the header tag, but please notice that there's a class here. So on all HTML elements, there should be a class in order for the front-end developer to then be able to style each and every HTML tag in CSS without having to use different layers of specificity. Of course, the class can be similar or identical from one context to the other, but it should be constructed in such a way, and we'll discuss this when it comes to CSS in general, but it should be constructed in such a way that you don't need more than two or maximum three classes, so three layers of specificity, in order to describe all the CSS of a website. That's the idea. As you can see, the header tag is not self-closing, so it has a content area and then it closes. And that's how it should be, of course. There are other tags which are self-closing. That means that they don't have a closing tag like here. Okay, let's move on to the logo. We have a logo. In most of the cases, something which is less fancy, so very mainstream and straightforward. You have two tags involved in the logo, an anchor tag and an image tag. An anchor tag is used because a logo is normally a link to the homepage of a website or to the homepage of a, let's say, a management tool, or to the homepage or to the main page of an application in general. And the image describes the actual logo. Most of the logos are images. Of course, instead of images, we could have used some other more exotic tags, but we'll go into that later on. Inside the picture element, inside the source set property, and inside SVG in general. But this is how a logo could look like. You have an anchor. The A tag is called the anchor. It has a class header logo. It has a HTML reference of slash, which is normally the homepage of the website. And it has a title. Why does it have a title? Because most of the links, most of the call to action buttons, anything that you click that is clickable on the website should have a title in order to reinforce the expectation of the user that that button or that link does what the user think it does. In this case, the link returns you to the homepage, so it says in the title, return to the homepage. Very straightforward. And then inside the anchor tag, you have a self-closing tag, which is an image tag, a standard image tag, which has a class name, it has a source. It's different from the source of the actual website. It's /img/logo.png, just for brevity. It has a width and a height, and we'll talk about that in a minute. And it has an alternate tag. The alternate tag is important, and every image tag should have an alternate tag, because by the alternate tag you give the image new powers, in the sense that it has a text attached, and either a browser or an actual user in certain contexts can read that text and know what the image means. So for either text reading applications for blind people, or in the case that this source is bad or is blocked in some way and is not visible, the alternate text appears instead of the image and lets the user know there should be an image there, which is the Artemis Bet logo. Now, about the width and the height, it's very important that every image has a width and a height, because when a browser renders an image, so the browser comes to this tag, and it says, okay, this is an image. I need to know the width and the height in order to construct a box model. If I don't have the width and the height, I go ahead and download the image and only then move on to the next tags in the page after I've constructed the box model for this, because this defines how the next elements in the page look like in most of the cases. So a browser needs a width and a height, and you can help it parse the HTML faster if you give it the width and a height by default. Even if it's a bad width and a bad height, it should not be a bad width and a bad height, but if it's a bad width and a bad height, it's better than no width and no height at all. So that's the rule. If you don't give it the width and a height, as I said, it goes and downloads the logo.png file. And that takes time, of course, precious time in rendering the page. And it measures by itself the width and height, and then it automatically places these properties here. So that's why it's important to have them there at all times. Okay, let's move on to the menu. This whole area on the top right side of the page contains several different navigational patterns. So you have a menu, which is this horizontal thing here. You have a button, which is the login button. and these are two drop-downs. But we'll only talk about the container of the menu first. So let's see. In order to describe navigational items, you need the nav tag. The nav tag is a shorthand for navigation, and it's ideally used in all kinds of navigational purposes to describe content that leads you to other pages or allows you to do certain actions inside that interface. So in the navigational, in the nav tag, you should place items with affordances in order to continue the design discussion we had last week. And in order to describe lists, you can use the UL tag, which means unordered list, and the LI tag, which means list item. Let's see that in practice. So you have a container, which is a navigation container with a class main menu. You notice that the class comes into play again at, in all the items in this HTML. Then you have the unordered list container. This is a container, this doesn't render by itself. It does have a box model, but we'll talk about it later. It has a class of menu list, and it has one list item in this particular case with a class menu item. Inside the list item, you can place anchors and so on, so items that help you with the navigation itself, and with, we've talked about anchors before, so you know how to use them. And the interesting thing here is that the unordered list container supports only a list item child. So if you declare an UL, you should not declare anything else but list items inside it on the first level. So this should be full of list items. The only exception, of course, is the comment tag, which is right here. This describes a comment, an HTML comment. And this is invisible to the regular user. It's only visible if you right-click and view page source. The thing is that this list item is one example. You can have N list items. You can have as many as you like. And in our case, you can have one list item, two list items, three, four, five, six, seven list items in this particular unordered list. And then you can have more things here. So as I've said, multiple lists and items can be here. For example, the login button, the help and language menus, and so on. So this is a navigational area, and it's described by the nav tag, and it has a list, an example list with some list items. Now, let's move on. These are some breadcrumbs. They're, if you look at them closely, this is a list of links. It's very similar to the menu in the sense that there are links placed horizontally one after the other. The only thing here is that we're going to use the same elements. So what do we use for the breadcrumbs? We use the same as before. So still a navigational container, an unordered list, which by the way should be ordered in this case. This is my mistake because the order matters. And I'll show you why in a moment. And some list, and the list item itself. Of course, these have different classes. This is important because you can have the same meaning to an HTML architecture, but different styling. And in order to enhance the meaning in this case, you can have additional parameters for the same HTML tags, so the navigation tag, the unordered list tag, the list item tag, and I've mentioned here the anchor tag and the span tag. So you can have additional properties here to define a micro format, which is readable by Google and other search engines in order for the results page to show you an actual breadcrumbs when you search for something. I'm going to try it out. I've never tried it. I don't know where to try it exactly, but let's have a go. So let's open the browser. Let's search for, let's say, Microsoft. It's a bad example. Okay. Office 365. Okay, it's not a the demo thing isn't working here. Let's try odds matrix. Okay, here we go. So this is the odds matrix page inside the EveryMatrix website. I think you all know the EveryMatrix website. You hopefully know the odds matrix page itself. It has, it's basically a page within the first layer of pages in EveryMatrix. And this is shown here. This is an actual breadcrumb, which is rendered by Google because of the breadcrumb microphone. EveryMatrix solutions and this page. You can notice here that this is exactly the case. So home solutions odds matrix. Home solutions and the page itself odds matrix. If we go deeper in this, and let's try it out now, bonus management. Right? This is home solutions odds matrix bonus management. Let's try searching for odds matrix bonus management. Here we go. EveryMatrix solutions odds matrix and the page itself bonus management. And this is due to the fact that we've used the micro format here. Let me inspect this. Right click and inspect. As you can see, this is not a nav tag, but it's a div tag. We'll talk about divs in a moment. With the role of navigation, it has an unordered list with the role of menu and an item prop breadcrumb and so on. So all these parameters are used in our example as well. Let's go back to the presentation. So, of course, it's more important to put the role navigation in order to achieve the same result, but it's equally important to use the nav tag because it enhances the content with more meaning, even more meaning than the role navigation. So it's quite, I mean, the role navigation and the nav tag are quite similar in what they mean, but using a nav and the role navigation makes it absolutely clear what you're talking about. Okay, let's move on. This is a slider. We won't talk about the content inside the slider. We'll just mention that this is a list again, a list of slides, and you have a navigation here which we'll not talk about. But let's introduce a couple of more tags. So let's introduce the section tag and the div tag. The section tag describes an actual section of the page. It's something that's not connected to anything else on the page. And it's quite independent in a way in its meaning. And a div tag. A div tag, compared to a navigation tag, they're both dividers. Div comes from divider. But the section tag has a certain meaning to it, like the navigation tag, the nav tag, like the unordered list tag. It's a divider with meaning. The meaning of section is that this is enclosed, that doesn't have anything to do with anything else on the page, it's self-sufficient, let's say. The div tag, on the other hand, has no meaning in itself. So this is an important separation between the two. The div tag can be used in any context you can think of, if you need a divider for functional purposes or for any kind of purposes that doesn't describe meaning. So our example here uses a section tag with a class slider, a div class slider canvas, an unordered list with a class slider list, and a list item with a class slider item. This is only for presentational purposes. In practice, probably this wouldn't be a real example because the div doesn't make any sense in this context. But let's say that your JavaScript is built in such a way that the section tag describes the visible part of the slider. The div tag describes an area which is twice the size horizontally. The unordered list contains the two slides, and there are two list items here. Let's imagine there are two list items here. And this, practically scrolling this inside this, controls the slider animation. So this is twice the size. I mean, the div is twice the size, and the section is just the visible size. Again, this is an example which is relevant just because div is different than section and is different than any other separator, block level separator, because it has no meaning. It can be used in any context without issue. Okay, let's move on to the content area. As I've said, these are two columns. This is the first column and this is the second column. In this particular context, of course. So we introduced two new tags, the main tag and the aside tag. These are both children of a section. The section is called content. This is the main content of the page. Inside the content, the section divider, we have two areas, the main and the aside. Again, these are dividers with meaning. The main, of course, means that whatever is inside here is more important than anything else on the page. And what's in here is secondary. They all have classes and so on. Okay, what about the page title? You've noticed inside the slider somehow, because of the design, inside the slider there's a page title which is called Casino, because we were in the casino lobby. The page title is unique in the way that it has to be an H1. Always. This is very old school because nowadays it's popular to use other types of tags and more H1s than just one. But in general, it's a best practice to have exactly one H1 tag inside all the HTML pages you build. And it should describe the entire page. It should be the title of the page, more or less. It should be the visible title of the page. And all other tags which are from H2 to H6 plus H group plus any other semantic header separators which you can think of are secondary to the H1. The H1 needs to be there at all times. It's important for semantics as well, because if you build a tree of content within a page, the H1 is always the first. It's treated by all the screen readers and all the other software as being the main title of the page. Okay, let's move on to the filter area. This is an area used for navigation, more or less, but not necessarily navigation, but for modifying the content. So modifying something within a page is usually done using forms. We won't go in very much detail today about forms, because it should take a separate a workshop in itself, but the idea is that in this filter area, you have a list of categories, you have search input, and you have a configuration drop-down. And it can all be inside a form. I've placed a warning here. Again, we'll talk about forms in another workshop, in a full workshop, because they're relatively complex in comparison to other HTML architectures. And it also conveys some functionality which we'll need to discuss. So this is an example of the form we've talked about. This is a form with the class game filters, and these are two additional properties which the form needs in order for it to be semantic and valid. It needs an action. I've just placed a slash here, which means that whenever you submit something in this form, it will go to the home page, which of course is wrong. But I've chosen this because otherwise it would span into a couple of rows and I didn't want that. Plus a method. The method, we'll talk about it again, of course, but it's the way you send data from the browser to the server or from the browser to anywhere else you want. And this time is post. You can also choose get or some other more complex types. Okay, and inside the form, always, this is a specification which almost everybody misses, the children of the form tag should always be field sets. So these are three field sets describing the three areas which we've talked about. The list of categories, the search, and the configuration dropdown. So one field set, two field sets, three field sets. You've noticed that they all have the same class, and in order to differentiate them, I've placed an additional class on this one and on this one. the search field set and the more field set. Okay. This is the game list. The game list is one of the most important things on this page. That's why it's in the main tag. It should be placed in the main tag we've talked about earlier. It has a sort of a title, which is relatively small, but it's important because it defines the current category as filtered from the filters we've talked about just now. And this is one of the last examples I'll give. Let's introduce a couple of more tags. So this again uses dividers if you like, but it uses HQ and ordered list. So this is a divider with a class game area, and inside this divider, which I've created for you can create dividers as many as you wish, just be sure to not create that many so that you can pollute you don't pollute the HTML with a lot of code. And inside this divider you have an H2, which is a secondary header with a class area subheader and the text popular games, and this describes the content below it. So you have created a divider, and inside that divider you have a header and some content. This is a general best practice inside anything that uses HTML actually. So you have a container of content, you have a header for that container, and you have some content for that container. And this content in this particular case is an ordered list. OL means ordered list. It's ordered because the order matters, because we have filters to define the order. So of course the order matters. This is not an unordered list, it's an ordered list. And last but not least for this particular workshop, we have a game item. As you can see, the game item also has a minimal functionality, which is by the way done in CSS. It doesn't require JavaScript or any other magic of that sort. And it's basically built out of one state, which is the default state, another state, another content area, let's say, which overlaps the first content area, which describes the actions you can do when you hover over each particular game. That means that you need an H3 for games, for the titles of the games, and you need some spans. You need some spans in order to define these types of icons, as you can see. Okay, this is a list item, which is inside that ordered list we've talked about. It has a class of game item. It has an anchor inside and a divider inside. The anchor contains everything that's visible in the first state, which is the favorite icon, the hot icon, the provider icon. You've noticed that the provider icon also has the provider as a class here. I can't select it properly, but here you go. And also it has text. Why does it also have text even if it's not visible in the design? Because of SEO. So it's good to have a lot of text inside your page in order for Google to actually be able to read something. So favorite hot netent isn't visible per se, but it's a content inside these spans, which is present inside all the games on the page.
Isn't it good enough to use images with alts or icons with titles?
Ideally, you won't use images for for icons, because spans. You have a lot of requests to the server if you use a lot of images.
Okay. Spans with titles, isn't it the same for Google?
Spans with titles is okay. So if you have a non-breaking space here or something similar, and you have a title favorite, it's equally okay. But having an actual content is ranks better than a title. So the content ranks better than the title. Alt tags rank better than the title, but titles are also important. So there are different levels of content, and some is meta content. So meta content ranks lower than content itself. I'm sorry, this is a mistake. Thanks for pointing it out.
Yeah, I have a question as well. Why span and not a div?
Because span, that's a good question actually in this context. This defines a divider, and it defines a divider which is block level, because these icons are block level, they're squares basically. Span is usually used for nondescript dividers inside content itself, so inside a block of text, for example. If you don't want that divider to span its own block of text, and you want it to be inside another block of text without hurting its layout or its appearance, and it makes sense to do that, it's okay to use a span. I've used a span here because I felt that I needed to describe all icons on the site with a span. It's just a convention, it's not a rule.
There's one difference between span, one real difference between spans and divs and display blocks on them.
Yeah, but okay, they both mean nothing.
And it's one unspoken rule that spans should not have anything, any other elements except text inside them.
Yeah, exactly. So spans usually only have text inside them, exactly. They both span and div.
It should, yeah. Mai e o diferență. Poți să spun un sistem de recent în care divurile să aibă anumite proprietăți și spanul are alte proprietăți.
Of course, you can differentiate between the span and the div in the design level, of course. But the idea is that both span and div are equal in the fact that they don't have any meaning attached to them. And the div is usually used for block level elements which contain much more elements than a simple span, which by convention only contains text, which Tika pointed out and is true. Okay, so we have three icons here. We have an image, which I haven't finished in describing here. Because I lack the space, but it should have a width, a height, and then a null tag, and of course a source, and an H3. This H3 describes the title of the game. It's lower in level than the H1, which describes the title of the page, than the H2 that describes the title of the container with games. It's an H3 because it makes sense to be an H3. If we had something lower than this in hierarchy, we would have put an H4 here, and so on. Okay, this divider encapsulates all the hidden content and anything that is shown when you hover over a game. This is done in CSS, you don't need anything else to do it, but the idea is that it's a separate divider in order for you to control it properly and not make a mess of the styles in the rest of this list item. And of course, as Bogdan pointed out, this list item should have ended in a list item tag, not in a div tag. Sorry about that. Okay, this is to be continued. We'll continue this with tags specific to the sports page, probably. And I think the next step in this HTML saga is to actually build some HTML live and record this. Questions? Anyone else have questions? No? Okay. Thank you. Thank you.